Okay, this video is on commercial real estate secrets. Yeah, that is right. Secrets. All these people are selling commercial real estate stuff for, I don't know, 1 to 2,000 bucks, and they're not even telling you anything because they don't even know anything. And it amazes me. So, I'm gonna just tell you some real shit. Okay, so commercial real estate. There's like three real ways to make money in this thing, which I'm gonna go over, and I'm gonna go over the whole nine, basically, enough to get you started to where you can find properties, get them under contract, bring them in, and we close them and pull out cash. The trick to this scenario is basically we can do 100% financing, but that requires a few things. Cooperative seller, a property with equity, or a property that is off market, which is going to be listed in all the places it has its classified ad at, and it's going to say price not listed. That means the guy's in on the game and he knows what's up and he's ready to play ball, and we can do a lot of things with it. The only trick on this is there's a little details behind it. So, I mean, if you do your part, yeah, I can do it, no money down, all that kind of stuff, and all that. But if you're missing a lot of the equation, like all the things that's needed, then yeah, anybody's gonna say, I need a retainer or something because you're not doing the things you need to do. Which, for a lot of argument's sake, a lot of people send me like three pieces of paper for wanting like 100 million or whatever crazy number, and they don't have crap and they have no third party validation, no third party anything. And I'm gonna go over all these things that's needed, and they expect somebody to do it, and then they say they got ripped off. Well, yeah, you have nothing on your part. Now, for the most part, everybody taking money up front for these real estate things, yeah, they are ripping you off. In general, if they don't have a track record or don't know what they're doing and not really legit, but yeah, some people like me and other people that are legit and have closed a lot of deals. I don't know. Normally, I don't take any money up front, so we'll just leave it at that. But I'm just saying, I'm going to give you all the information that you need so we don't have to worry about that. Okay, so there's three levels of commercial real estate funding. First, you have like your single family or duplexes or 1 to 3 to 4 bedroom homes. Okay, so the average on those, on worst case scenario, you're looking at 20% down. So, like on a simple 100,000 bucks, you can get 5 houses worth 100,000 each, and you got $500,000 worth of net worth. You got 200,000 cash, you got 20 houses, and you're sitting on $1 million just off 200,000 cash. That's kind of old school. It's how it used to be. That's what I used to do to clients back in like 2001, 2002, back way back when. And get them have like 20, 30, 40 properties, blah blah blah. Later on, now I realize after years of doing that back then, the next level is the commercial real estate, which is apartments, hotels, and after you've accomplished some of those, you're going to get into like your retail shopping centers and things like that, malls that need to be renovated, all that kind of type of commercial real estate. Those are the three main types. Maybe business, some business office buildings. Once you've accomplished that and you have a portfolio of around, I don't know, I'd say maybe 1 to 2, 3, 4, 500 million, then we'll get into private equity and get into other types of projects that make bigger money. But this is a good start. At the very beginning, we may start you out with like $1 to $5 million projects. Depends on how much cash you have. Ideally, you'd want to have like, well, say if you got 100,000, that's simple. You got right there is 5 houses, or you got 200,000, that's 20 houses. That's level one. But level two would be anywhere from like 200,000 to 500,000. You're talking in 1 to 5 to $15 million properties. At 500,000 to $1 million cash all day long, we're talking 20 million and about 20 million and up apartments, hotels, and you know, certain other commercial real estate in that range and pulling out $1 million at a time. Now, in order to jump through those equations, some things can be overlooked and passed over. That means you have to have a cooperative seller. Okay, so I'm going to give you a couple examples of strategies at work. One is example, like kind of like a simple case study, is the Commodore Hotel. I don't know if you know about it, but like Donald Trump bought it. Well, got in on it way back in the day when he went there. He didn't even have any money. All he had an apartment. He just drive around in a limousine in a suit all day, and he went to Commodore. He tried to buy it, and the guy didn't know who he was, so kicked him out. He went and got Hilton, told him he had the Commodore, and he put Hilton and the Commodore together, got right in the middle of it, got the whole thing done with no money down, and redid the whole deal. Same with the rail yards. Nobody wanted it. It was the worst real estate land in New York. He bought it. Basically, they gave it to him. So he spent 10 years changing the zoning and getting things all set up and asking everybody in town for 10 years to get money on it. Nobody would loan him money for 10 years. So he got the idea that he hired a crew to move dirt around in the daytime and move it out and bring it back at night. And then the whole town freaked out and all wanted in on this deal because he talked so greatly of it and what he's going to do with it. Everybody jumped in and wanted all the money, wanted to give him all the money. So he took the highest bidder, and to this day, that is the highest selling real estate piece of land in the United States. And it's so highly oversold at the moment, it's still not sold. And that was probably like, I don't know, probably 10 years ago. Basically, I'm telling you, the deal drives the equation. You do not have to have the money to pull it off. You just have to have the brains to do it. Now, ideally, if you have 100 to 500,000, it makes things a lot easier. Okay, so the whole trick is finding the needle in the haystack, but it's not really a needle in the haystack. If you have a property, you're going to look for properties on Craigslist, Zillow, and probably LoopNet. Those are probably your best places to find them. On those classifieds, you're going to find properties that are not price not listed. That definitely means the person's interested in these cooperative. You want to find those or ones with equity. That means it's been around a long time, has a lot of equity, and be able to get a hold of the seller. You can't just go through a realtor because you're going to have to make this kind of arrangement with the seller. So a lot of your apartments, even motels, a lot of motels, especially motels. Motels are super easy to get into because almost all the sellers want to get out of them. And there's easy ways to do like a wrap on their mortgage and put it on your mortgage. So, but the motels are cheap. I mean, they're not that much money, and you want to stay with things over $1 million. I really can't believe I'm saying it. Things over, I would say, $1 to $5 million. You're going to start out with this. Normally, I'd say $20 million when you have $500,000, but we're going to go something small, so like $1 to $5 million range. Motels, apartments, or hotels. So apartments, motels, probably be your first stop. Find ones with sellers that seem to be motivated. The price isn't listed. Look for on Craigslist, LoopNet, Zillow, or do a Google search. Okay. Now, there's basically four types of four types of ways that you want to have the seller cooperate in the way we're going to pull this off. One is the seller is going to just flat out say he will carry a second mortgage. Okay, no problem. The second way, which is if he's cooperative and you say, hey, Mr. Seller, I've got this way I can finance the property. I can get you cash. I'll pay you a little bit extra. We just have to refinance in your name, and I'll refinance in his name on an assumable loan. I put a certain clause in there, and you can assume the loan. He can just relieve himself with the clause and a quit claim, and boom, he just refinanced the property in his name. And then, like, literally within a matter of an hour, 2 hours, or day, we can have him assign it over to you without him being at fault or liable 100 million percent. So literally, technically, you could buy the property, pull out 300 grand, 500 grand, whatever it is, and default on it, and he can walk away scot-free with nothing. And these cooperative sellers will do it all day and night. Motels, hotels, and apartments. Assumable loans really work within the range of, I don't know, one to five, $1 to $10 million type of stuff, apartments. Also, when you are looking at apartments, you do want to find ones that are generating income. I mean, it can be 70% occupancy. I mean, the more occupancy, the better. But if the property is lower occupancy or run down a bit, it can be done. The more run down it is, the more cash you have to have, because you got to put in room for down payment, and the less it'll appraise for. The thing is, if we have a property with equity and he's cooperative, then we can manipulate the sales price, which is the whole key to pulling this thing off. Now, the third one is an under the table second mortgage, which is the lender sees one and the seller and you have an agreement on the side, which nobody knows about technically, and you pay him back at a later time, okay? Or the fourth one is the lender says you have 90 LTV, 65, 75, 85, 80% required, and you have a seller that's cooperative and says, okay, here's the cash for your 20 or 10% or 35% down. Now, normally, like you, on your single families, are going to source and season the funds, and your funds going to have to be in your own bank account, and you can't pull it off. But on some certain commercial deals, you can pull it off. So the trick to doing this is getting cash. If you only have $100,000, you work with the $1 to $5 to $10 million range. If you have less than that, fine, you just have to find a more cooperative seller. This is easy. You say, how it seems so hard? No, it's retarded easy. I could look on the internet right now and probably find you 10 deals, and I guarantee you could probably close 8 of them. Maybe 5 if you're stupid. I mean, the properties listed on Zillow, Craigslist, or LoopNet, and it says price not listed or price not shown, all those guys have gotten into those properties that way. That's why they have them off market. And they know that's how they want to get you into it. Now, why do they want to do it? Well, their margins are probably screwed, and yeah, maybe they're losing money, or well, they pulled out a lot of cash. Now, later on, as you get better and learn more about what you're doing, you're going to realize, well, they got in it, pulled out cash, kind of like you're going to do, same thing. But you can take a bad situation from them and create it into a good one for you. It's just gonna, you could laterally cross collateralize it, or laterally improve it, or change things with the property, generate more income, change rents, all these kinds of things. And the books, like Wall Street says, you don't want to buy them if their books are cooked, but I'm saying that does change and alter the numbers on the equation. The whole thing is, if you get in the property at whatever interest rate, we may get you in at a high rate, and it may be breaking even, it may be losing it, but it's not going to matter if we pull out on a small deal, which is, lordy, $500,000, maybe $100,000 is embarrassing to say, because I don't ever do anything that small, but I have certain clients that want to get into this stuff so bad so early, I'm going to tell you this stuff now. So yeah, we get in with the baby, pull out $1 to $500,000. I'm sorry. Okay, we pull out the cash, and so the property's losing a little bit of money every month. Who cares? 6 months later, we refinance it, change the margins, get the low rate, get get the occupancy up, and boom, you have a profit-making deal. You just made the money on your pull that you pulled out, and you have an asset that's going to generate money for a long time. You can hold on to it or sell it, or we just use it as collateral and bridge it onto the rest of your portfolio and run to the moon with it. That's your first deal. That takes like no time at all. You just get on the internet and start looking on Craigslist, LoopNet, and Zillow. Start trying to get a hold of the owners. Go to the property. If it has a realtor, try and go and talk to the owner. Most of the time, you have a realtor on a commercial deal, they are ignorant and going to kill the deal because most realtors are stupid as shit. They don't know anything about, like, they don't know anything about the electrical, the plumbing, the way that the roof is, the anything in it. They don't know about the numbers or the income statement, the balance sheet, the assets, expenses, the rent roll. I mean, they just know how to show the property, do a contract and these things. So you want to avoid the realtor. If it says for sale by owner, home free. If you got realtor on the equation, you might throw it out or try to go straight to the property and get a hold of the owner. That's your best bet. So once you find a property, you're going to negotiate the deal. You're going to come up with a value that he wants out of the thing. Maybe pay him a little more if he's going to carry a second. No matter how we could, no matter if he's cooperative, I can get you in with no money down and pulling cash out all day and night. Now, when that does happen, what else has to occur? Well, we have to have an appraisal, or they have to have an appraisal, a previous appraisal. That's a good start. Then we have to run title work, environmental, EPA, and all these things. You want to first ask him if it's a apartment. You want to get a hold of the rent roll, his financials for the last 3 years, which is his balance sheet, income statement, and taxes. And if he's a little shady, you maybe want to ask for his bank statement so everything matches up. But if he has a CPA or third-party verification, you're fine. You have all this stuff. We'll put a clause in the contract. Everything's fine. The numbers add up. Boom, you get in. It doesn't matter if it's a little loss, because right now, buying, losing properties, and you can pull out cash, you still win. We can change it later. And it's getting your portfolio. The trick is getting your first one done. It's not that hard. You just start doing it. You go to the path, like on the weekend. You're going to tell yourself you're going to go look at 5 or 10 of these apartments, complexes, and motels. Motels, they're super easy. And literally this month, you should be able to pull off at least 1 to 3 or 4 of these things. I mean, they're simple. They're easy. The thing is, you want to have a little bit of cash or your business going to where you have cash flow, so where you can use some money in case you want to have extra things. We'll pull out cash on the property, but you got to have a little cash so you can run around and do the research and pull these things up and start looking at them. But it's better to start and do it now than not do it at all. Okay, so now you found the property. You get them under contract. We get the appraisal, the title work done. We get all this stuff done. I'm going to go over like your due diligence. Basically, you want to find out the rent roll. You want to see when the guy's leases are coming up with all the tenants. You want to find out what the occupancy is. Look at the whole scenario and then start thinking about the numbers, what you might want to raise rent to, how much money you're going to charge, and then how you're going to rebuild the property. Like I was saying earlier, when I first started out and I did mortgages, I'd get clients into like 1 to 20, and that started getting really easy. Then I get some clients get up to 30, 40, single family to 1 to 3 to 4 bedrooms. Easy, you know, 200,000, you got 10 homes at 100,000, you got $1 million net worth, and it's building up appreciation, it's writing off the taxes, and you got income cash flow of like, you know, $200 per property. So, you know, you're making like, I mean, a client we've been making like $20,000 on just $200,000. It's because you got $20,000 down payment per property. You got 10 properties, so it's pulling in $20,000 appreciate. So, you know, that's money. So then we started getting into commercial real estate and stuff. So ideally just have cash to start pulling these things off. I really discovered how to get into the commercial stuff because I started going around talking to these banks and got in with this hard money group, and I started flying around and started closing commercial deals. And one of the first ones, I mean, I started getting myself in a lot of them, and then I started getting my clients into it. And one of the first ones, I got a client into it, and he didn't know anything. And we're on the phone with this luxury apartment complex in New York. I think it was like $40 million. And the seller and the realtor were on the phone, and they started asking my client about his background. And he started saying he didn't have shit, didn't know shit, and like, don't ever say that, okay? So the guy got super pissed off. And I said, okay, it doesn't matter. I'm going to pay you X amount of $1 million over this price. We're going to do the thing. And he got super mad. And anyways, we started yelling at each other, and he hung up, and I hung up. And then about 15 minutes later, the realtor called back and said that that was the son of the real owner of the building. So, his dad wanted to talk to me, and I'm like, okay, great, I'm gonna get into more trouble on this deal. I didn't care. So the dad called and said, yeah, that his son had gotten into managing all his properties, and he had $500 million in his portfolio. And that, that is how he built his portfolio, by doing the same thing I just said. And he said he liked my style, and he was mad at his son for being, you know, the way he is, because he couldn't control the way, how he was, the way he raised him. So he sold that portfolio to my client, all 500 million of them, all $500 million worth of it. And the thing is, that's why I knew for sure that I was right on the right track. And that was probably, I don't know, like 9 years ago. So the deal drives the equation, not the cash. But you gotta have the action and the mind and the brains and get the stuff done and the contract to go with it. So if you have no money, you better come up with all these other things. And that means get their financials, their rent roll. If it's a hotel, you got to get the star report and all their numbers for the last 3 years and get everything in the contract and everything together. And that means ideally writing a letter of intent. Normal letter of intent is just say, hey, I want to buy your building. My name's XYZ. So on this type of letter of intent, you're going to say, my name is Joe Blow, I want to buy a building, and you're going to write out the equation. You're going to say, I'm going to pay you X amount of dollars over the price you're asking for carrying back a second mortgage, but if we have a good appraisal come in at a good amount when this thing is off market, and no matter whatever LTV we have, he comes out with more money than what he even wanted, you come out with cash out, and the deal closes. And that's how you make, well, almost $1 billion. If you keep at it, you'll make $1 billion. And that's how all of them do it. And that's how nobody tells you how they do it, because they don't want you to know. That's a fact. So, there's how you do it. The other piece of the puzzle is, it uses basic information, is like the LTV and the debt service coverage. The debt service coverage is basically the two most important things. The LTV, loan to value, you're going to just however much the price is, you know, divide by the percent that the lender will give you. And the debt service coverage, those are the two most important things. Debt service coverage, debt coverage ratio. Debt service is your loan payment. Debt service coverage or debt coverage ratio, same thing, is your net operating income divided by your debt service. Okay, that means your all the net operating income for the year divided by all the debts for the year is going to give you this ratio, and it's going to equal 1.0 or negative 1.0 or over 1.0. At 1.0 means the property is breaking even. At 1.0 and above, it means it's making a profit. Anything below 1, it's making a loss. Now, most of your lenders are going to say, we will lend at LTV of 65, 80, or 90 normally, and 1.2% debt service coverage. So that's about all you have to know. But I can do all the numbers and show you all that stuff in detail once you have a deal. You have to just go out and get a cooperative seller. I mean, the rest of the equations I can teach you later on, and you can learn later as we go. But those are the most important things that you want to know about. Net operating income is good just because it's important. But once you get in the property, the whole thing is to fix your margins where you have better margins and produce better net income and generate more money. So that means you could charge for extra revenue assets on the facility, as in adding in a laundry room or fixing up the laundry room, more money for the washing machines, more money for parking, extra places for storage, more money for storage, raising rents. If we have enough money, you might want to remodel or convert some of the property into other things that make more money. It's called lateral conversion, where you would take a property and you would change it to, like, if it's a motel, you would change it to condos or office condos or things of that nature, or an apartment where you would add, change it into condos and sell out each of the units piece by piece for complete sale, or you just take the units and maybe make two into one or do different things converting it, or just raise rents, upgrade the place and change it, and then change or give a little discount on the rent and give longer contracts or something, or give longer contracts, a little less rent, but you have a longer contract, it still equates to money. Doing all these different little things, doesn't matter. You just got to find the property with a cooperative seller, and then we can get you into the rest and teach you the rest and go over all the other stuff. So that is pretty much it. I know this is a little long, but I had to kind of get to the point. Technically, you'd want to have some cash. I don't know, the more cash you have, the bigger things we could get into. So we get into it 6 months, refinance it after you've already pulled out, you know, depends on the deal, 200 to a million bucks on the first deal, first deals per property, and then keep going from there. So that is the secrets. This, the real secret that no one's telling about, is seller cooperation and off-market properties, assumable loans, which no one tells you about because they don't want you knowing that, and under the table seconds, where the seller carries the part of the loan under the table, or the seller actually gives you the cash for the down payment of, I mean, all these deals, and seller carry back the second. So these are only possible when the seller is cooperative and there's equity in the property. So if you're wanting to get in commercial real estate, like a lot of people call me, and they want to get into developments, you can't get into developments because that's LTV, loan to cost that it actually costs to do, which means a development or developmental stuff or building things cost like 20% down to 35% down cash. So that is later on, after you have these under your belt and you have maybe I don't know, 100 million in your portfolio going up, then you might want to get into, I'd say 100 to 500 million, then you might want to get into developments, or then after that, private equity, which is where you own only 30% of a property, but it's such a large project or multifaceted deal, it's worth doing. So that's it. So give me a call at 312-473-4163.